hear us?
Do a little microphone check. Hello?
Check, check, check.
Hi, hi. This is Necro Butcher.
This is Thirst Moore.
It's nice to be here. As some of you, or most of you know, Necro Butcher, Jorn, wrote his memoir of being in Mayhem, starting in the mid-80s, and published it last year. And I had heard about this book when I was doing an interview with a Norwegian journalist last year before my band was playing a few shows in Norway last fall. And I was very excited to read this because I was always an incredible Mayhem enthusiast. I really was fascinated by the band through the years, through all their changes from their, you know, when they first start and when Dead joins the band, and then after all of the hoopla around, you know, Dead and Euronymous's departure from this planet, and then, you know, the band's continuation through the different members, and especially through the different singers, and to its its current incarnation with Attila and forward. And this band always fascinated me, how they always sort of maintained a very sort of contemporary stance of playing new progressive metal, and with, that was distinctly from their place here in Norway. Even though Attila is this Budapest kind of crazy singer, it just made the band even more sort of universal and kind of extremely interesting. So I was really curious about this book, and my partner Eva and I, who have a book publishing company called Ecstatic Peace Library, which has existed in different ways throughout the years, and we've released books on music and poetry and art, some little things and some bigger things, and so we were very curious about this book, and she found it for me in Stavanger when we were playing up there last year, and it was the only copy I could find in all of Norway, and it was in a little CD store next to a McDonald's in Stavanger, and there it was sitting by itself, was Necro Butcher's book. And so I read it the whole time I was on tour here, but I was reading Norwegian, which I don't really understand very well textually.
No,
maybe not at all. But I can sort of make out a few things. And the book was rife with photographs and ephemera from that that Jorn had kept under his bed for all these years. And I think there was a couple of journalists who always said, "Jorn, you have to do this book." And he's like, "Okay, okay." And he finally did it. And each piece of the pictures and the ephemera inspired him to write his memoirs of this period of being in Mayhem. We called the publisher here in Norway, and we got the English translation rights, and we translated it, and then I was able to read it as I was reading it, proofreading this book, you know, hundreds of times, going through all the grammar and the different kind of things just to move it into this realm of English. It was just fascinating. So I read the book about 100 times. So I think I know more about Necro Butcher than Necro Butcher knows, maybe.
Could be.
And so I'm really proud to have published this book just in English for those who necessitate having to read it. But it's out there, and so that's why we're here. And we're here to talk about this book and talk about other things. And we'll talk amongst ourselves. And at some point, we'd like to talk to you if you're into it. Why don't you tell us about how this all came about, like putting this book out? Like, was this something that was something you've been interested in doing for a long time, or what was the history of how it started?
As you said correctly, a lot of journalists have contacted me over the years and wanted to write my memoirs or wanted to do some kind of book. I always said no, because I thought it was too personal. I tried one time with an English writer, and while we were doing it, I actually started to think about, probably my mother wouldn't like this too much. So I kind of put it on ice. And then 2 years ago, I had two journalists, a photographer and a journalist, from something called Not Odag, which is a free paper here in Norway, wanted to do something for a 30-year anniversary 2 years ago. And I showed them, as I always do when people come to my house, I put on the coffee, I show them my photo albums from the 80s, and this bloke said that, hey, I know somebody at Askehav, the publishing house. And I'm like, Askehav, as in Askehav Hagefest? Is that those people? And, you know, the most respected publishing house in Norway. And I'm thinking, okay, that's the right place for us to be, or for me to be. And I came up to the office there, and it turns out that the editor is an old fan and also used to play in a hardcore band herself, actually Nasneem Khan. So things fell into place, and then I accepted it. And we sat down. It took us a year to write the book. And then I got it back to read through it, and then I was kind of shocked, because it's like when you listen to yourself for the first time on tape, your voice, for example, it's always a little bit strange. That's the closest thing I can compare it with. When I wrote the book, it was like hearing myself in my own head. While I'm reading this, I'm thinking, Jesus Christ, this is just how I said it. I thought the guy with my ghostwriter was going to do something funny about it, you know, to write some. And then Jørn said, with a smile on his face, blah, 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 you know. It was not like that. It was just like, fuck you, asshole, blah, blah, blah. Just straight out, you know. So actually, I had to use 2 weeks to kind of retusjere meg selv. Just said it in the English, Norwegian, because I didn't know the English word. I had to retusjere, what betyr det på engelsk? Altså, edit. I had to edit myself. yeah, because it was too heavy. I started to think, this guy didn't deserve this kind of, you know, that much slander, you know. And that guy, maybe I should just, you know, not mention that story and... you know, maybe that was the wrong thing to say and stuff like that. So I had to take out a lot of things. And then my ghostwriter said, no, you have to keep that and have to keep that. And he sold it to me. Like, he told me why it should be there. And I told him no, first, absolutely not. And then I had to admit that the story had to hang together. Otherwise, it would be too much space inside. So he kind of tricked me into talking about stuff that actually I didn't want to talk so much about. But to make it kind of understandable, then we had to bring up some extra things.
It's a great idea. I mean, because you have all of these images that most Mayhem fans have never seen. Mm. That you have, and these first photographs of the band when you're first getting your shit together.
And I was thinking, you know, when after the internet and all this Facebook, Instagram, MySpace, and all this, when that happened, I was start to think that maybe I should just start to release one photo just for the fans. That was actually my plan until this book idea came, and it was supposed to be actually just a picture book, just pictures. And just I was just thinking, this photo was taken in Ski, 1985, left to right, blah, 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 blah. But that wasn't enough, apparently.
But that's what's so cool about it, is that each of these photos, it's like, it makes you remember.
Yeah.
It jogs your memory. And I always do that, too, when somebody's interviewing me about something in the 80s, you know, which isn't that long ago, but it is quite a while ago, isn't it?
Yeah,
when you think
it is.
We were younger people. But and all of a sudden, they show me something or they ask me some question about something in the 80s, and I like all of a sudden all this memory comes out, and I start thinking, oh, yeah. And then we went and ate this horrible pizza at this place, which I really love about the book, because it's not about... you know, celebrity name tagging and all this kind of stuff. It's about like the actual day-to-day banality and drudgery of the road of being in a rock and roll band, of where you go from one point to the next, and maybe there might be some people there who come see you and how they react. You know, that's early stuff about, you know, just kind of you're young, you're hungry, and you just want to do what you're doing, which is just playing in a rock and roll band, and you're just leaving home and you're going and doing it, and it's just like come hell or high water, whatever happens happens, and those are what those memories are. And in retrospect they're beautiful memories, but at the time you remember it was fucking hell. Right, so
it was awful.
And that's what I really loved about the book when I read it. It wasn't like this typical memoir of narcissism. It was talking about like relationships, experiences, and I was very inspired by it.
I didn't even think about that, because that was not consciously. I read it in the interview later, that somebody had said that this book is free from self-indulgence, or self,
look what I did.
The bragging.
Yeah, right.
It was just completely nothing of that. It was actually the opposite. That actually I talk myself down instead of up, which is the upside of every book that comes out in this kind of way. And, you know, everybody's bragging about themselves and name dropping and all this. I was just thinking that the best way to do this is to write exactly what happened. Just like small anecdotes, small stories, day-to-day things. Then people can make their own opinion about what happened, instead of the tabloid version. You know, everybody knows, especially in Norway, the tabloid version, the journalists and what they wrote in the 80s and stuff. And that was so far from what we were doing. We didn't even recognize ourselves in the meter at the meter, spaltemeter, aviser. Just tons and tons of fucking newspapers all the time was talking about us, but we didn't even recognize ourselves. Is this us they're talking about? No. They had just misunderstood everything, but they did it deliberately because, you know, negative stuff sells papers. So anything you can put Satan, Nazi, or any other bad thing on, you know, like big types on the front page, you know, that sells. If you are content and everything is good, you know, they won't even write about it, you know. So this is more like, and I'm not preaching, I'm not telling you what to do or what to think, or I leave that up to the reader to find out for themselves. And since this is talked about and written about in so many books and stuff, and here people from miles, 1,000 miles away write about this shit all the time, and books come out all the time, and people, the press calls me to review their books about me and start to piss me off. It's like, why should I give free advertisement for these shit books that just write wrong stuff and didn't even have any decency? I mean, you can even wrong, like, you see a picture of somebody and then it's your name under and it's in the book.
Yeah.
It's nothing that pisses me more off than writing a book and then you know yourself that this is wrong. And for me, books should be educational, not
the other... Exploitational.
Yeah, exactly.
When we had a bit of a book launch in London, which is where I've been living for the last few years, which was really great. We did something at Rough Trade Records and a small a bookshop in this area that many bookshops are at. And we learned that the Norwegian embassy in London was very interested in celebrating this release. And what is your feeling about that, actually? I mean, at one time when you're talking about like the 80s, when people mentioned Mayhem, it was just like, well, what do they know about Mayhem? It's like, well, we know that they're Satanists. And we know that they're murderers, and we know that they are insane. So now, all these years later, we have the Norwegian embassy saying,
"They're arsonists. They're very bad people."
And they make beautiful music. So what do we know? So now things have changed quite a bit in the last 20 years.
Yes. it didn't. Well, you know, it took some years to try to clean up the misunderstandings and stuff, and people love to talk shit about us, and we became some sort of an enemy of the state here, and was supposed to be absolutely no mentioning of us in any positive way at all. Negative ways every day, almost, you know, as much as they could write. Slowly, people start to recognize that this actually is a band that play music and not just doing these scandals. And I think the turning point was that it was a friend of mine that works for the NRK. He had this program called The Day Is Yours. It's a humoristic program. And I thought to myself when he said, asked me if I wanted to come to the show. And what he does is like he makes fun out of the people he invites in a bad way. Like one of the other guests, he would be respectful for the guy, but he was holding his wife's ass under the table. Like Alex Rosén is his name. And this is a Tarje Søviknes. His wife is a famous politician that couldn't keep her hands on the, you know, some youth people in the 16-year-old girl, big scandal thing. Yeah. And anyway, so they made a funny program about him. And and I was the next show, and I thought to myself, or I told him, man, I don't like to be made fun of, you know. And he said, well, this is a humoristic program, you know, so... So then I think to myself, okay, fuck, I'll do it. Because people need to see that we are actually people and musicians, and we need to play. And we were banned from all the festivals and from the venues in Norway. So it was about time to do something about it. And after the show, anonymous house mothers in their 50s start to call me and say, hey, Jørn, you're a good guy. Who would believe that, you know? Wow, such a great person and stuff. And after that, it started, that was in 2000.
Yeah.
So from then on, it started to build. And the foreign secretary, foreign department here in Norway, traveling around the world, and they're in Costa Rica or whatever, and they ask some people what they know about Norway, and they say, Mayhem. And all the diplomats and stuff like, Mayhem? And then they had to start to learn this in the Utenriksdepartementets school of diplomats. It's a, you know, they have to learn about Norwegian black metal now to be, otherwise, we can't send them anywhere.
Yeah.
You know? You know what I mean? And then when the embassy in London called and said that they were proud of the book and wanted to treat me for dinner, I'm thinking, hell yeah, let's go to the embassy and have dinner. But they took me to a restaurant instead. Maybe next time.
So, you still live in Norway?
Yeah.
You still live in ski?
Yeah.
Till the day you die?
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Yeah. The more I travel around the world, the more I know that this is the best place. When I was young and stupid, I thought that, you know, this is the worst place on earth. And after visiting about 60 countries, I understood that this is actually the best place to be. And now I pay tax for how many years? I'm 48 now, so I don't want to piss off my pension. So now my next goal. So it's good to have goals, you know. So I always have a goal, and my next goal now is to keep it together for 19 more years, or actually 17, because then we would be, or 18, then we would be celebrating our 50th anniversary.
Oh, yeah.
And I would be 66 and ready for my retirement.
66?
66.
I like
six
how
eight,
you like,
mean, no,
I like
5'8", 6'8", 7'8". Remember that?
Yeah.
Something else is between us.
No, I'm 58. I was born in 1958.
You're 58, I'm 68, and your partner is 78.
Well, she was born in 78, but she's not 78. At least I don't think
she is. We're talking about the day we were born, not... I thought that was funny. So
the book was published on 6/16.
Was it?
Yeah, June 6th. You didn't know this?
No, you picked the date? No, I didn't.
Oh, man.
It's so evil, you know. Very evil.
What's your next book?
I was writing a book 15 years ago. I started the book. It was called Necrologues. And it was going to be about all my car-stealing friends, speed freaks, and hooligans, and junkies, and all these people that passed away way too early and didn't get any good words in the paper. Just say, you know, like, was nobody bothered to write anything. And I was thinking to myself that that would be a good way to present these guys. With a little story from Necro himself. Then it stranded because some people said that I would have some problems with lawyers and stuff because I was going to use real names and maybe their moms and dads didn't want the rest of Norway to know that, you know, that their son died in a car crash because he fell asleep on heroin or, you know, like, or whatever the story was. But then again, who gives a fuck about anything anymore? I mean, I've been run over all the time and people write shit about me all the time. I try to sue people. I try to call people and say that I'm, you know, I know where you live and stuff, but it never ends. It never ends. So
that's not a phone call I'd like to have.
No.
I think it's good that you didn't, you know, you mentioned earlier, not to go back, but you mentioned earlier that you, at one point you were thinking of like all these photographs and ephemera you have, and you were thinking for the fans of putting them up on social media like Facebook and all this other. But it's good that you did a book. Mm. Because, you know, when you put a photograph up on Facebook, they own it. I mean, that's what happens. You lose the proprietary of that photograph. Mm. You lose it. I mean, once you publish it on their social media site, they own it.
Mm.
And it's just like, that's weird. Mm. You know, and that's something that, you know, a lot of people don't really understand when they use Instagram and all this kind of stuff. You're kind of giving your property. Your
and not only that, you're giving it
property.
Away
you're giving
for
it,
free.
You're giving it away for free
for
immediately.
Free.
Once you do it, it's gone.
Yeah.
Because once you place it in their construct, they own it. And there's nothing you can do about it from then on. And so it's a weird thing. It's a very contemporary malaise of a thing. Mm. So I'm glad you didn't do that.
So that was one book. But the next book... because this is the first 10 years of Mayhem. 84 to 94. Mm. And after that, we started to tour around the world after that, basically. And I had my one-time cameras. I never owned a camera in my life. I bought this at the supermarket, these disposable cameras. And I would drag them around the world, and sometimes I would find them in my suitcase when I come back, you know, in the wrappings. And sometimes I would find them at the airport on the last day. I'm thinking, fuck, I didn't take any photos in the airport, you know. But sometimes took photos that was kind of sometimes even illegal photos, you know, like you would be sent straight to, you know, for, yeah. And those photos I have, and all those are mine. I took them myself, and not like this book. A lot of these pictures I didn't take. It was from old photo sessions. But the next book would be only private photos taken by myself, because everybody has seen all those press photos in all the heavy metal magazines anyway. For every album we do, we have to do a press photo thing, and it has to be in three different clothing, three locations, once.
I hate that.
I hate it.
That's the worst thing about being a band, is like doing the photo sessions. Like, we have
I love these bands that only have one fucking photo of themselves. One photo, that's it. That's great, you know. But now it's like Scream, like here in Norway, Scream magazine wants exclusive, Metal Hammer Norway wants exclusive, England, Terrorizer, Metal Hammer. If they don't get exclusive pictures, they won't even do the story sometimes. So you just got to do it. And sometimes it's more work for me, actually, because I feel I'm not like a photo model. Or you might think so. But actually, you know, that's worse than actually being at the rehearsal place and try to figure these songs out, than to be in front of a camera and people say, yeah, look cool. Am I not cool enough now? No, more cool. Can't you do some cool? Or some whatever, you know. Like. Or now it's like when you come in and just stand there and they say, well, put on your war face. It's like, maybe 30 years ago.
Put on your war face.
Yeah.
See, I never got asked that before.
You didn't?
Yeah, well.
Well.
That's interesting.
Because you're bad to the bone. You don't need any.
So Mayhem, it seems right now that you guys are just more alive than ever. I mean, just like you're going to South America next week or something and doing
a
tour. Next month. And then you're going to the USA and doing a tour there after the new year.
Mm-hmm.
New record coming out.
Yep.
You guys are totally thriving.
We're just doing it.
And you feel good about it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
We've never been better, I feel, musically now than before. Now we have the right constellation of musicians. Now, after playing so many shows and playing these songs thousands of times, we start to know them now, you know. Sometimes I even forget, you know, like when I'm on stage, sometimes I get a little blackout when I start to think, what is the next riff now? Fuck. And then the trick is to just forget about it and then thinking my fingers will probably remember it.
Yeah.
And they do. Because I start to think about something else, like look at something and then, yeah, that was. You know, so sometimes it's like
sense
that.
Memory, they call it. Yeah, I do the same thing.
Yeah.
Sometimes it'll be like, oh no, like I played this 6 million times and I have no idea what to do.
Exactly.
And you just kind of there. You think about like, you look away and then your hands just do it and it's like, oh, there it is.
Yeah.
Sometimes not. Sometimes you just.
Yeah, but these people don't know that.
Yeah. When the rest of the band looks at you and like,
yeah.
You're stinking up the place.
Yeah. So. Yeah, it's true. But in this kind of music, you know, we are perfectionists, you know.
Yeah.
I think everybody who really, put their heart into it, they wanted to make it right. They don't want to, you know, they want to make it as good as possible. And we are our worst critics, and we make some small mistakes, you know, and we are pissed off and we smash the backstage up and people don't understand anything, you know, and nobody heard it, you know, like that mistake. But we are, you know, but now, last years, we are less pissed off on backstage of the shows. So I think we're doing better now. Because back in the days, we would just have to tear each other apart, you know, like because they make mistakes and stuff. Like, because it's disrespect, too, you like. You disrespect me by playing wrong, you know, in the band.
Right.
Yeah. Especially if they're drunk or high or, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, it's unfair.
That's not good. That's not professional. I mean, we used to be drunk as fuck for many, many years, but, you know, we don't accept that anymore, especially from people we hire. Mm-mm. We can be fucked up, but not you.
You know? Exactly.
Especially crew. Crew is not allowed to do anything. But then again, you know, they become our friends and they hang out with us and suddenly think everything is cool, and then they get shit-faced and then suddenly they have to work.
Yeah. Well, when you have a crew of people working with you, what people don't understand, that they're the first ones in and they're the last ones out. You know, and they have to stay focused.
Mm, absolutely. And I must say that we also have a really good crew now.
Yeah.
I see one of my drum technicians here tonight, actually.
Salute. Cool. I don't know what else to talk about. If anybody wants to ask a question, this young lady right here.
Can you tell us about some of the things you took out of the book?
Oh, what did you take out of the book?
But that's...
Where's that
that's
book?
That's out! Okay. All right. Don't tell anyone, okay? The main thing, since I'm stupid honest sometimes, is that I gave my old vocalist a lot of shit. Sven-Erik Kristiansen, maniac. Basically, because he was a drunk motherfucker and made my life fucking hell. And I just wrote basically, you know, not what I thought about him, more like what happened. And then when I wrote back the same lines, I'm thinking, he didn't really deserve this, did he? Mm. So that's part of the things. I just
when you talk about your
it's
old
like in one sentence I tell him that they are stupid ass motherfuckers, you don't have to tell that later. That's what I mean. I already told them, they're assholes. Then didn't need to, rub it in, more like that. Yeah. So all the details are there, except that I didn't want to rub it in to people who, I felt kind of didn't understand, anyways, they were kicked out of the band, and after some years, you start to think only all about the good things and forget about all the bad things.
You seem very forgiving in the book, in a way, which I really was interested in. Because in a lot of memoirs, people use their books to retract some, a little revenge.
Yeah.
I think like Morrissey's book or whatever. The Smiths, he spends so many pages on just like, I'm getting you back, motherfucker. And he's just like, he does it. Mm. Like this drummer gets slammed and this guy gets slammed or this journalist for like 10 pages.
I have a black book.
Well, there's that, right?
Yeah.
But but you didn't make this book into your black book in a way.
No, because I don't want to lower myself down on the level of those fuckers.
But I also noticed that in the book, it's just like, you're also kind of like, we're all human here. And we're all young at the time. And so you're just like,
It's liberating to write about that because you can always say, oh, I was young then.
Yeah.
It would be stupid to say that now in the next book. I wasn't that young, but but I paid my dues. I did all my time in jail, so I'm good. A second chance, please.
Anybody? Yes, this young lady in the front right here. Oh, come on.
Okay. This is actually the publisher here.
Is there anybody on this side of the room who would like to ask a question?
Yeah.
Actually, right behind this young lady here is this gentleman here.
Yep.
Trying to see.
Something very familiar.
I'm
going to try
to describe you physically, but I won't.
I have a question for both of you.
Okay.
What do you think are the similarities between Mayhem and Sonic Youth?
But first, where? Have you been to my place or something?
No, I haven't, but I co-directed a documentary about the Black Metal.
Now I remember you.
Ah.
Okay, there you go. Okay. And then the question was?
Yeah, what do you think are the similarities of both of you between...
Well, somebody just asked us this earlier.
We are very, people say that, are you related? Because we are kind of, We are kind of the same size and stuff, you know. No, that's a good question. The guy is all about alternative music, and he knows about what it takes to be in the middle of that. Put up music that most people don't understand and take all the shit for that. So we felt that we were the opposite side of that narrow type of music business, you know, like, so that we had in common.
But I think we're both really coming from places where we're interested in the outsider element of rock and roll music. I was always fascinated by that growing up. It's like I was always interested in the people who were doing radical music on the margins and not so much the popularizers. I wasn't, not that I had any problem with popular music. I mean, I enjoyed it immensely. But I was always very fascinated what was going on, the ideas that were happening, the underpinnings of rock and roll music. So when I would hear things early on in my life, you know, like the Velvet Underground or the Stooges or Captain Beefheart, and then when I was 19 years old, seeing and hearing bands like Patti Smith and the Ramones and such, that resonated with me. I was really attracted to that. I found it more stimulating intellectually, and it was still kind of true to like the raw aesthetic of rock and roll. And that's what I aligned myself with really early on before I even had, I think, any articulation towards, like, what do I want to do with my life. That's what I did. And I was always interested in things that were taking chances. And before punk rock, I was always interested in what was going on in heavy metal, like with Black Sabbath and Judas Priest and these bands, because it just sort of seemed more, it just seemed more uproarious than James Taylor or Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young, which I admired, but I was more kind of into like that energy, you know, of what was going on. And punk rock sort of encapsulated what I liked about that, plus it had individuals in it who I could relate to. You know, there's like Joey Ramone, who's as tall and geeky as I am, singing in a band. That's cool. I'm not Robert Plant, but I can be like Joey Ramone or Johnny Rotten, who has like buck teeth and bad eyes and like pimples all over his face. That I can relate to. And so that to me is that drew me in. I was at a perfect age for that. But I always liked the more sort of noisier aspects of the music. I liked the spirituality of noise. And so when I, even in the early 80s, when the new metal bands coming out of England, like Venom, were really interesting to me, and I liked what they were doing. And then hearing about what was coming out of Scandinavia, particularly with bands like Mayhem, that was always just like, great. I mean, it's like, what is this, you know? And it was like, it was a genre unto itself. I mean, Jorn was playing in punk rock bands before he played in, you know, him and Euronymous started Mayhem anyway. I mean, so punk and metal were always sort of related, and alternative music, for whatever it is, like art rock or whatever, to me, it's all about just being open to anything radical in music, be it avant-garde jazz or just weird classical compositional music or academic stuff or just like tribal music from all over the world. That's what it's all about, is like getting these influences and bringing it to your own experience, you know. And I thought that's what was going on in a real genuine way with Mayhem coming out of Ski, you know, this band that's making this fucking racket, you know. And they're just having fun. They were inspired by what they were seeing in metal and punk and stuff, and just wanting to be, you know, a gang, you know, making noise. And I think maybe if there's anything that relates to what Sonic Youth exists in Mayhem, it's that. And nobody else in Sonic Youth was listening to Mayhem. I'm the only member of Sonic Youth who can even name a Mayhem song. You know, so it's not like...
But those people would probably name drop like Brian Eno, Klaus Schulze, these people. And we were also into those people.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly.
Because we were into everything that was uncommercial. Like, how could they put out this? This is completely shit. We love it. You know, like, this is in between radio frequencies. For an hour. How genius is that? This is great stuff, you know? So this is where we're coming from. That's why I'm trying to say that alternative rock and this black metal thing is actually the same ideas, you know, but it just came out a little bit different because we are different musicians. We think, you know, we are different in that way. But very interesting when, first of all, my book publisher Oskar and Nosnim calls me completely, you know, can't even almost talk. It's like, I got Thurston Moore. He's going to release your book. Like that.
Yeah, who?
What? Huh? Yeah, the guy from Sonic Youth. I'm like, huh? Sonic Youth?
What?
Wow. This is, you know, do they listen to this kind of music? But then, of course, I understood that they had this book company. And then when we first met up, we started to talk about stuff we had in common just to get the stuff going. Mm. And it turns out that we are the same. You know, so we have the same friends, you know, like I used to hang out with Didi Ramon. He knows Joey, one of my favorite producers, Rick Rubin. He knows those guys, you know, hanging around with Beastie Boys, one of my favorite bands of all time. So we had a lot of good, you know, it was natural to talk to Thurston. Felt like I met an old friend, actually.
And I never think of my whole thing with Mayhem is like they're a defining band in the genre of black metal, but I never really think of them primarily as just like a black metal band. I think of them more as like this ferocious kind of rock and roll band that pioneered what became black metal as a universal kind of like genre of music.
Because we didn't call our music black metal, because Venom already had this album out called Black Metal. So we wouldn't steal their ID, you know, like we would say, okay, we play brutal music. We don't play heavy metal, because everybody knew what that was, not so heavy or yeah, you know, not so extreme. So we have to find another word for it. So we just call it brutal metal, brutal music. And then everybody started to say to us, oh, you play black metal. And we tried to tell them in interviews, no, we don't play black metal, we play brutal. Venom has the right to use that, blah, blah, blah. And in the end, record stores also start to have their own section, black metal. And Mayhem was there. And it's always the same with music. People and the press, especially the music press, have to put this in a box that they can put a name on it. Otherwise, they won't understand anything. So we ended up in a box called black metal. And I thought to myself, okay, if that's going to have to, you know, if we have to be in that box for people to find our music, you know, that it would be on the black metal in the record store, so be it. Fuck it. I give up.
Yeah, but we're like in the box that says alternative rock. And like, what does that even mean? Alternative to what? Like,
yeah.
You know, what's the alternative to the alternative? I mean, it's like,
yeah, it's the same story, like, basically. You know, like we are in the middle of it, and other people tell us, what we are about, you know. And we were like, that's why I write the book, you know. I'm saying, I had enough of this shit. No, you write, read the book before you're asking more stupid questions.
Which brings me to my next, does anybody have any more stupid questions? It's somebody in the very back there, I'm pointing at you, maybe you will be the one, yes.
Yep.
You have a stupid question.
Where do you find a rebellion or art or uncommercial music today in popular music? Do you find it, and if so, where? Are there relevant words to use about popular music?
Yes, you can find it. I just bought an album called Rio from a band called Duran Duran. It's completely crazy stuff, but it's pretty good. So you can still find it. Some other places you can find the band called Depeche Mode, which is also pretty good. Today, everything is washed out. I don't think, you know, it's black metal, aggressive music, alternative music. Everything is like come together, because everybody needs to interpretate music. And that's why we have variations of music. And like black metal, for example, is now jazz metal, symphonic black metal, arty black metal, all kinds of stuff, you know. The people come from all dangles and mangles, from jazz world, from blues world, and want to interpretate this type of music. And then new music comes out, but it's still under the same umbrella. black metal. A lot of bands, you know, wagons that come and go, like Hairspray music came, went, punk rock came, went, heavy metal came, went, came back again. But we, the aggressive music has had this fine upwards in all, you know, just building, never really dip down, just slight, you know, going that way. So it's still evolving, you know, in ways that I wouldn't even dream to think of.
Yeah, I think it's always evolving. I mean, regardless of the dynamics of dissemination in the culture, I don't. It's just different now, and it maybe it's easy to cry about like how it's not as much fun to like find something or just, you know, that kind of search for something. Where it actually took some kind of legwork as opposed to just opening the laptop and like plugging in what you want and there it is, and then you have all these different options and you can sort of satisfy yourself immediately. That's, you know, that's a really interesting kind of situation to be in, and I think it kind of creates a culture where you don't really have these kind of shocks in the culture anymore, where you have like the Nirvana coming out, you know, or even the Beatles or whatever, something coming out and actually being so strong in the culture that defines a specific demographic. You don't really see that anymore. It's pretty much, you know, because everything is kind of available and there's all this work being done, and a lot of it's just great, but it's not going to sort of it's not going to kind of rise above and be like, you know, the voice of the people. And because it's almost as if we kind of succeeded in sort of doing that. And now we're so lucky because we can all share so easily, you know, this information all the time. And there's something good about that. And there's something really sad about that, you know, because it takes a bit of excitement away from, you know, just the activity of it. But at the same time, the truth is that there's always great work being done. I mean, when I go through customs and ask me what kind of music I play because I have a guitar in my back, I say I play experimental rock, and they look at me like, "What is that? What is that? What does that mean?" You know, and it's like, and I was like, "That's what I do. I experiment with the music, and it's just like I don't have one thing I do that I feel satisfied with. I'm always experimenting, and I mean, I don't." Say that so much to the customs agent, I just say experimental rock, and they just kind of like, okay, get out of here. And but you know, it's right now I just think it's like what has to be done is just good work has to be done, and there's always going to be a majority of it's just going to be really bland and generic, and you have to sort of weed through it, and you can't sort of tell generations that are younger than you that your days were more important or better, because they're not. They're just those are just your days, and so what's going on these days in popular music? I find the older I get, the more disinterested I am in it. Even though I always keep my eye on it, and so when people say, "Oh, the greatest thing happening now is EMD, right? Or EDM? Sorry, that's how square I am. EDM." Electronic dance music, which is like, that's the big thing, you know, just like really sort of like creative ambient techno music that's going on. Mm-hmm. And it's like, I hear some of that stuff and it sounds great. And I hear some of it, I just don't care. I find it really just sort of dispassionate, and I don't really care, but I hear the ideas. And so, but who am I to say, you know, that is of lesser value than like what was happening in my era of the 80s with Sonic Youth and Butthole Surfers or something. But so it's, you know, to me it's a really interesting time. I think we're sort of in a bit of a shift because of this idea of having access to shared information like instantaneously, and we're all trying to sort of process what this is. And right now you're sort of seeing the advent of like of people making physical objects with books and records and places and stores that actually sell this stuff and have nothing to do with the digital medium. And it's not disparaging the digital medium. It's like digital medium has it's such a kind of a great thing, but it doesn't have physicality. It doesn't have any vibrational quality to it. You can't download this glass of wine. And so that will always be the reality there. And you can't download a Mayhem record. You can download the picture of it, and you can hear what's going on there, but you're not going to touch it, and you're not going to hold it, and you're not going to smell it, you know? You're not going to just like, that whole thing, that physicality of what's being presented is not there. Mm. So you have, I don't think that's going to disappear. I think there's a lot of anxiety about that disappearing, but it's not. It's just going to become more sort of focused. Mm. And so I'm really interested in it. But I don't know where it is right now. I do think we're in this transitional place in our lives on this planet with, like, you know, digital medium, we're going to sort of be okay.
Well, I think,
you know,
so too.
We're going to be okay. And the idea that, you know, people playing rock and roll music or whatever should be on pedestals and be rich and famous because they sell so many records, that's not happening so much anymore. Beyonce sells a lot of records. Justin Bieber sells a lot of records. Mm. You know, we don't sell a lot of records. Maybe 20 years ago, we probably could have, but it doesn't happen anymore so much. But so what? I mean, it's like, you know, what you're doing is the same as like working in like a charity shop or working anywhere or having a job that has dignity and responsibility to it. That's what you do. It's work, and you're doing work that you love, fine. And you make whatever revenue you make, cool. You put it back into your work or whatever. Mm-hmm. But this model where, you know, you're in a band to become rich and famous, I like the idea that that is now bullshit. that doesn't exist because the internet has sort of destroyed that. Mm-hmm. It has destroyed the record companies, you know, and so these ideas of just like making you rich and famous, that's not an aspect anymore. You know, that's a failed dream. And, you know, I say good riddance to it, you know. I would love to be rich, but I'm not. I can pay the rent, but, you know, it's like, you know, none of us, you know, we're not like, we're not Justin Bieber yet.
Thank God.
That's the end of my lecture. Sorry.
Yeah. Not Justin Bieber just yet. you're right about that. The music industry is it's a different thing altogether. When we started, it's a completely different world. But the question pops up sometimes, and my answer is that I will probably be at the rehearsal place in the weekends with my friends, even though if we didn't have any success, because I love to play music. With success, it means that you get to play somewhere, release an album, and then the next album you release, you are sad if it doesn't sell more. If you have a new concert, you're sad because not more people came. So it's all, and you didn't get more money, as you should, and you think you should. So it's about that. It's about the appreciation. You don't feel appreciated if you don't get paid when you got paid already. But I think that I would be doing that this without any pay at all.
You still do
if
it.
They never paid me in the first place. Right. Because now they already paid me, so that ship is gone. I don't do anything for free. Drink with both hands and try to enjoy myself. I'm going to go bananas at the coffee table over here with all the sweets and cakes and stuff. I have a pretty good cafeteria up here.
What's your experience with Trondheim? You've been here a few times, obviously.
Yeah.
You said you played in this room.
Yes. We were one of the first bands. Paul!
Yeah.
How many bands played here before us? One, two, three, or nobody? More than that? No. I don't think that. Maybe we were number two or three or something. Very early here. There was, while the building was not even finished. What I like about this place here is, like, as you can see, it's actually divided, separated from the rest of the museum. It's a wall behind here, which means that the music here doesn't resong into the rest of the building, which is very interesting. That you can have a gig here and probably do all the office work and have have the whole, you know, normal day going over there. So, and all this is the, you know, top of the line, light, sound wise, is, you know, Paul could probably tell you that he loves his work. And even the people that put up this sound to get the maximum out of this room is the most professional people in Norway. Drammen Light Design that put this shit up. So, yeah. People got very worried about when this place came because they thought that all the clubs were going to go bankrupt. But since this is the kommunen, fylkeskommunen, or the state that owns the shit, then it shouldn't be any... that should be a non-profitable thing going on here. And I think that it managed to keep it that way. Since all the we play at the Studentersamfunnet next month. So...
You must have played in Trondheim in the 80s.
No, because we had some problems with some members that was hanging out at the graveyard. They couldn't come to rehearse or anything. So we had to, you know. So unfortunately, we didn't make it before the 90s, and we played in a place called Vita Scena. It was the first time. Mm. And my vocalist used to have, as part of his stage clothes, he was have knives on him. So he was like fiddling around with the knife there, and somebody from the audience came up and grabbed the knife. So the day after, it was in the winter time. So outside was a big chunk of blood on the stairs, and then the street, you could just follow the blood trail from this fan. And I was very impressed by that. I'm thinking, these guys are fucking nuts up here. It's true what they say about all this moonshine drinking and stuff. Like, you know? And then I got together with a chick from here. So I, you know, I came up here maybe a little bit too much. Because, you know, now I enjoy not coming so often. But I have great friends here. I have Øyvind here. Bands I know from Trondheim, and some great friends, and I like the fact that there's still places to play for a rock and roll band here, even though it's in the middle of Norway. And then you have the Rockheim Museum, of course, which is the crown jewel here, next to the Nidarosdom. You know, it's
most everybody here from Trondheim? I mean, I'm asking en masse. I don't like raise your hand if you live in Trondheim. Yeah. Oh, so most everybody here is from Trondheim. You like that?
Hey.
It's a little something I'm working on.
Well, okay.
Hey, yeah. Ooh.
Very alternative. I like it.
How much time do we have? We can go on all night long because that's what we do. But
I have a question for Jørn.
Yep.
Because I remember in the mid-90s in the Oslo, you were supposed to play at a festival.
Yeah.
Someone was complaining, so they threatened to pull the support, the financial support from the festival. So a man was removed from the festival. And then I remember that you played in a venue in Oslo in 96 or so, where I remember there was a police car outside the venue. And I was thinking, I was living in Oslo at the time, on a Friday night in Oslo. I think there's a lot of violence, there's a lot of drunk people fighting. The police should be everywhere but outside of the main.
Absolutely.
I think these are, you know, the 666 most peaceful people in Oslo right now, at this Friday night. But I was thinking you have all this adversity with the police and the media. And I think that every time that Mayhem is mentioned in a Norwegian newspaper, they feel obligated to mention that one member was killed, one member committed suicide, there was a Nazi who used to play in the band, and so forth.
Yeah.
And no matter what happens with Mayhem, they have to mention this.
Facts, they call it. Facts.
beside, you know, the huge... Because people
absolutely
don't necessarily bother to read the article, but they read, okay, here's a Nazi.
It's like me, just look at the pictures.
There's all this there, but at the same time, in the recent years, you have the Norwegian diplomats, they're being taught about Mayhem and everything.
Funny thing is that we...
You have all this. So you have an exhibition with Nickelback, Bethel and the Mayhem, so on and so forth. Do you feel that the balance will... Is it right? Will it, the balance be, ever be right? Or will the past always be right?
Can I ask a question? You know, like, I would turn that around and ask a question, and that is, are rock and roll supposed to be for, you know, isn't rock and roll supposed to be the alternative thing, you know, for, you know? And that's the only, you know, like, back in the days they said that Elvis was Satan, and then Beatles came, and then they were, oh, it wasn't Elvis, it was Beatles, actually, that was straight from hell. And then Stones came, and they sang about Satan, too, you know, even though that, you know, when you listen to Beatles albums backwards, you know that they're singing, you know, that they're in league with Satan, too. And then all the bands took over that role, and we suddenly we were Satan. We were the, you know, the worst thing ever. And then it shifted over to some rappers after a while. And then I started to go to rap shows because, you know, that, you know, is this where all the bad people are? You know, like, and that's back to your question. All the drunk people and all the hellraisers and all these fuck ups. And all the violence and shit, that's in all other kinds of music than metal. Metal music and fans are the coolest, non-violent people. Even they sing about violence, because then they get it out, you know, out of the system. And not like these other people that walk around in their fucking suits with ketchup, prosciutto, drunk as fuck from their fucking work on a Friday night, fredagspilsen, and then get violent in the taxi queue back home, and you know, this is the fucking people who listen to folkemusik, danseband. I mean, Terje Tysland, slo ikke han det lensmann her? Oppi Terje Tysland is a lovely artist. Yeah, he's an old guy, plays folk music, yeah. And he was in his camping area, and his woman had acted out a little bit. So the sheriff came to take away his woman, and he wanted to defend his woman's honor, and clubbed down the sheriff. And this is the guy from this place here. So, you know, I'm just saying that it's more violent in this dance-orientated music or and metal music that is supposed to be about violence. So it's weird. It's weird.
I think what this gentleman's asking, in a way, can you hear me? Is about accepting or denying your reputation. It's like this band has a reputation for having members who are problematic and like whatever. It's like, in a way, it's like, you are kind of responsible for what you present, and you try to sort of work together as when you're a group of people, and there's a certain group responsibility there. But you're not really responsible for everybody's ideology, etc. I mean, it's like, and especially when you're coming up and you're finding out who you are as people, and things happen, it's whatever. I mean, I think whatever Mayhem is and what defines Mayhem is first and foremost is their creativity as musicians, as playing music. And it's like whatever bullshit that goes on personally between members, that happens in a lot of different bands, and it's like, oh, well, that stains my band, or like, oh, we're proud of that, or whatever. It's what you have in life, you know? I mean, things happen in your families, things happen in your bands, things happen in your jobs, or whatever. These things kind of become part of your resume in your life, and you don't, sometimes you want to distance yourself, whatever, but you can't make them disappear, and you have to understand what they are and how they sort of how they paint your life as you go along. So I would never think that Jorn's just like, yeah, whatever. I mean, it's like, that's what happened. And even his book is that. It's like, this is my reality. This is what happened. Look at it. Look at the pictures. Look at us. Have, you know, take what you want. But really what it comes down to is like putting the record on and listening to like what these guys did as creative people. And that's ultimately the answer. You know, it's just like, you know, I mean, there's certain bands that I know that I would like, I was like, oh, you know, those people are kind of, I don't know if I want to listen to their music just because of what they represent or whatever. And it's like, you know, I mean, I remember somebody saying like, well, why would you listen to so many classical composers like Gustav Mahler or whatever, because he was a sympathizer with Adolf Hitler. You know, so it's like, well, yeah, you're right. You know, Gustav Mahler, you know, fuck him. But he, God, you know, the guy wrote some incredible compositions. And it's like, how do you sort of, you know, how do you balance that? You know, how do you balance the work, you know, that sort of comes from a person's, you know, spirit and soul or whatever, from their own sort of weird ideas of humanity and society? You know, how do you deal with somebody, you know, some of the great writers and poets who are just kind of, you know, their ideologies are problematic, but their writing is, you know, they're beautiful as poets. Mm. That's always going to be an issue. I think that's always going to be an issue in art, because you become public, you know, through your art. And, you know, and all of a sudden you become, it's kind of, it's political. You know, you become a bit of a politician, because you have to be true to it. Mm. But, so I never think, I try to always sort of separate that from like my, you know, whatever edification or enjoyment I have with music and art. You know, like who these people are? They wife beaters? I don't know. You know, maybe they are. Are you wife?
Well, I don't have a wife, so I probably am.
I thought you were married.
Yeah,
I'm sorry. I don't
okay,
know
yeah, I used to be married. That's oh. Long time ago. And I also think that, you know, when talking about that, it's a little bit different, but in the same vein, society toughens up, hardens up, and people are, you know, they need more aggressive music. To put up an example, like my mother would always say that, why don't you get a pretty girl to sing for your band? Maybe you make some money. You know? And that was back in the days. She actually says that to still, but you know, she doesn't know, don't have a clue. But here's the thing. We are sitting watching TV after Sunday dinner, and there's a sports news going on. And these people are dear alpine skiers, squirrel, and all these people. They go down the hill in 200 kilometers an hour, and the music that the NRK, National Broadcasting, put to amp on the top of the film is even more aggressive than I ever did myself. And I hear it. And I look at my mom and my stepdad, and they're just like a normal Sunday evening and watching the sports news. Nothing is going on. And I'm thinking to myself, don't they hear this? The music that they hated and didn't understand and wanted to have a girl vocalist and stuff. Now they can hear Cannibal Corpse while we're doing and looking at our athletes. That, you know, like the treasures, the national treasures of this country, and the music goes in the background and it's heavy and brutal as fuck, and nobody takes a notice of it because it's so, now it's so normal. You know, back in the days, I remember we never saw Venom, ever. There was no pictures, no videos, anything, and then on Swedish TV. They're gonna show a video from this band Venom, and we were like, "Wow!" Waiting a whole week, tuning to the TV, put on the SVT, got ready, and this Anders Tegner had this. He was writing for this stupid magazine called OK, which is like his glamour, yeah, yeah, horse hairspray. And then the video came on, it was Bloodlust from the first video they put out. Yeah. For 5 seconds, and it was blasting, we were like, yeah! And then they turned it off and said, what the fucking shit is this? They just turned it off. And we were like, what? What the fuck happened? And just wrote immediately on their, you know, on their, not the thank you list, but the kill you list on the demo. Please kill Anders Tegner and NSB and all the other fuckers that fucked with us. You know, because we were thrown out of the train and, you know. Anyways, so it's funny how the everything, you know, society hardens up and toughens up. And now we have live wars on TV, like, you know, when the Iraq war broke out. And so now suddenly we fill a gap that nobody thought was there. And now it's like all accepted, and now even the Prince of Norway is a big fan, you know. So, I mean, State Department pays you dinner and stuff like that. Invited to Rockham to talk to all these highly educated, great people, you know, that would never, you know, even put a crown in my chips cup from McDonald's, you know, when you're sitting in the street. But now look at here, they already pay 50 crowns to see it. It's unbelievable. So it toughens up, it hardens up. Society toughs it up, and now we are accepted. Before we were freaks, yeah, now we're heroes.
That's right. I'd like to thank Brockheim for having us here. That was really nice of you. I'd like to thank all of you for coming. I'd like to thank Eva doing so much work and Yasmin. And both these young women in the front here, they're the ones who have really put this book out. We're just a couple of clowns up here.
We just like really right. We get to talk and get the overshining.
Thank you, everybody.